प्रोफेसर रुबीना अब्दुल सत्तार मैम प्लीज मैम।
Thank you, sir. The next resource person is here, Professor Munawwar sir. Presently, he is an assistant professor in Department of English, Objective Arts, Science and Commerce College for Women, Malegaon. He is MA set in English, stood first in the set exam of 2016. He has led many years experience of teaching in schools and higher education in institutions. At present, he is serving as the coordinator of IQSC of JT Arts, Science and Commerce College. I welcome you, sir. Please.
Thank you, ma'am. Dear participant, actually this webinar was based on only one session of Dr. Raj Tribhuwan sir, but I thought that it would be a little shorter because Raj sir has belittled his session. Actually he wanted to share with us something more, but he considered my session and I thank him for that. So I start my session, which is entitled as I Study of the Theater of the Middle Age. First of all, I would like to clear the intention behind selecting this topic is that the students who are aspiring, who are trying to crack the NET set examination, so I think they face some difficulties, some problems in studying the history of literature, especially the Middle Age history, because you see, in the history of English literature, the Middle Age is so complicated, so distinctive in its perspective, in its events, that sometimes we get jumbled that how to study in proper sequence all the events of the Middle Age. And now one more thing, Middle Age or any age, according to historians, have been divided differently. Generally, the division of time especially while studying literature, we see the first age, which is described as ancient age, in which we include Greek and Roman period. Then Middle Age, which is starts with the emergence of Christianity, or especially after the fall of Rome in the 4th century, and goes on till 13th to 14th century. And then after the 13th to 14th century, the modern age starts. So historical divisions are just like this. So I will try my best to cover the theater, the dramas of the Middle Age, so that it help you in your preparation, in your studies of English literature. As Raj sir has told you that generally it is found that the students are not studying literature as it deserves. They read books, they read notes only, or they go through some market materials, or they go through some shortcuts for covering, for understanding the literature, but it is not possible with the help of those market materials. And now, dear students or dear participants, I have divided my presentation into three parts of the middle age. First, I have entitled as the early middle age or age drama in Britain, which starts from the 44th AD to 950 AD. See, here we will try to understand the basic of English dramas, basic of English dramas. Dramas were there in the Roman period, in the Greek period also. Not only they were there, but one of the most powerful medium of arts, powerful literary form. They performed dramas, they showed dramas to the audiences and changed their mentalities, their minds, their ideologies, their mindset. That's why we can say that drama has always been, in ancient period especially, a very powerful medium for changing the society, for changing the mentality, for changing the psyche of the viewers. But we are here studying only the British dramas. And the British drama starts in the middle age, in the middle period, especially from the 44th AD to 950 AD, which is called the early middle age dramas. See, first, the first form in the middle age of the drama was mime. It was called mime, which the Britishers inherited from the Romans. Mime is actually the word derived from the word mimetic or imitative quality. So mimes were played both in public and private or household theaters of ancient Rome. So middle age dramas start in the mimetic form or in the forms of mimes. So first mimes were played in public, sometimes in private places or sometimes in particular household. Then all the mimes were in fragmentary forms. They were short, they were farcical, they were satirical, and they had dance, song, and acrobatic skills in them. And you see, mimes were there before the emergence of Christianity. When Britain was a pagan country, it did not know, it did not have Christianity. So at that time, the early form, drama form was mimes. So mimes were earthy, body, and scarcely objectionable. So you see, in mimes, all the sexual materials were showed. They were very bawdy, they were very rough in their representation. And you see, because of the absence of Christianity, they were not objectionable. People accepted mimes, people showed, watched the mimes on the stage and without any objection. Even you see, mimes were praised even by the writers like Seneca. Seneca is one of the best dramatists of the world, Roman dramatist who has written Attic dramas or Attic tragedies. Then mimes were tolerated even by the Juvenal. It means in the Middle Ages, mimes were tolerated, mimes were accepted even by the great dramatists of that time. And now we see the impact of mimes. See, mimes were so famous, so popular in Britain at that time that in the first century AD, the Emperor Domitian ordered the role of a bandit in the Laureolus by popular mime writer Catullus should be taken over by a condemned criminal in the final scene so that a real execution can be carried out. See, this event, this incident shows that how impactful, how powerfully influential dramas or mimes were there in Britain. That the king, the emperor, Domitian, ordered that in a drama, a particular scene should be shown or should be represented in a real situation. Means in the drama Laureolus, which was written by Catullus. So you see, in this drama, the last scene is based on the execution scene. in which a criminal is executed, a criminal is hanged till death. So you see, that scene was chained to the real scene on the order of the Emperor Domitian. He said that we will show this scene in a real situation by putting the real criminal, by putting the real culprit in that scene, and the original scene of execution will be shown. It means that we can see that even the emperors, the kings, gave so much importance to mimes, because they knew people are watching mimes, people are getting the effect of mimes so much on the stage. That's why he changed the scene to the real one. Now, one more incident shows that the mimes are very much influential in Middle Age. You see, in the 3rd century AD, means you see the 1st century as well as the 3rd century, both are the pre-Christian centuries in Britain. Christianity came in Britain in 4th century. So till that time, mimes, dramas, which were copied, which were inherited from Rome, from Greece. So they were watched, they were liked very much. So in the 3rd century AD, the emperor Elagabalus wanted to see simulated adulteries replaced by the real thing. See, means on the stage, some unreal scenes were there. Unreal scenes of adulteries were there. So this emperor said that those scenes must be showed really. Means adulteries must be shown on the stage in the real way. Means real human beings, the real scenes, real events should be shown. It means they were so much under the influence of mimes that they wanted to change the scenes to the real one instead of the simulated one. Simulated means unreal scenes. Now let's see what happens or what happened to the drama or Middle Age drama after the emergence of Christianity. See, Christianity is the religion of monotheism. It believes in one God. Definitely, whatever religions believe in one God, they are not very much friendly. They are not very much supportive to art. They don't like arts because they believe that only God is the most beautiful. Only God should be copied. Only God should be magnified. Only God should be praised in the work of art. That's why especially Plato had said that if you are writing poetry, so poetry should be written in the form of eulogy. Eulogy means in the praise of God, only in the form of hymn. It means monotheistic religions are not friendly. They are not very supportive to arts, especially the interpretative arts like drama. So what happened after the emergence of Christianity? See, the Roman Empire converted to Christianity under the Emperor Constantine, who ruled Britain between 306 to 337. Means you see, the whole Britain converted to Christianity, became monotheistic religious country, and definitely many apologists, many theologians came there. Theologists came and they started writing against drama. They started writing against theater, and they were very much hostile against all types of acting, all types of representational arts. Now, for example, you see in 679, the Council of Rome required English clerics to ban both jesters and players from their premises. See, even Rome, which was a pagan country before the Christianity, became fully a Christian country. Even today, we know that Roman Catholic religion or Roman Catholicism was established in Rome. And they passed an ordinance in the Council of Rome in 679 that all the jesters means all the actors of mimes, all the actors of drama should be banned, and all the players of the drama should be banished from the premises of churches. They should not be allowed, they should not be accepted in the church campus. Now, an English diplomat, Alcuin, in 8th century advised that. See, means one by one clerics, one by one theologians, one by one priests started attacking drama, even the actors. by saying different things. So here, as an example, we can see the diplomat Alcuin in 8th century said that it is better to please God than the actors. He said that we should not write anything in praise of actors, but we should write everything in praise of God. Now, we should better to have care for the poor than for the mimes. So here we can indirectly know that how Alcuin is saying that we should ban mimes from the churches, from the premises of all institutions, and we should start taking care of the poor. We should take care of the social matters instead of artistic matters or the matters of art. Even in the 9th century, Charlie Manny in 9th century decreed to put to death any actor who puts on a garment belonging to a priestly rank. See, means Charlie Manny also in later periods of Christianity said that means one by one harsher and harsher rules were brought about against the dramas. See, this one means if an actor puts the garment of a priestly rank, if an actor wears the clothes of monks, so that actor will be put to death. And it means now actors cannot even copy, cannot even create the dramas based on priests, based on churches, based on holy things. So we can see that in the Middle Age, especially after the emergence of Christianity, the environment, the surrounding, the background was not favorable for dramas. Now, the second segment of the second category or classification of Middle Age, which I have entitled as the High Middle Ages. See, this High Middle Age, which starts from 950 and went on till 1300. You see, in this period, one drama which was not there in the early Middle Age, mimes were there, but mimes were banned, and now the new drama form started in the High Middle Age, which was called, or which is called, liturgical dramas. Liturgy is actually a ritual prayer which was performed by public or in the public by the Christians. So liturgical drama means the dramas in High Middle Age started, which was basically meant for the churches. See, acted within or near the church, relating stories from the Bible and of the saints. You see, means in this High Middle Age, drama has become fully religious. Means no secular element remained in it, and dramas were fully Christian, and dramas were based on the stories of Bible as well as on the lives of the saints which were mentioned in the Bible. Then this liturgical dramas have its root or their roots in Christian liturgy. Liturgy means a public religious ritual, means the people gathered together in churches, and at that occasion, at that time, they performed liturgical dramas. And you see, at that time in Britain, the high language, the official language was Latin. That's why the liturgical dramas were written, were performed in Latin only. Then earliest traces is found in 10th century. Liturgical dramas are basically found in 10th century. Then it increased in length and sophistication and flourished in during the 12th and 13th century. Liturgical dramas become very much fashionable, very much sophisticated. New ideas, new things came up into them, especially in 12th and 13th century. It means you see, as soon as the dramas became religious, Christianized in 10th centuries, so they started becoming so much popular. See, in our country, India, dramas are not so much in vogue. We don't give so much importance to dramas, especially in religious matters. But in Britain, dramas became very much Christianized. Now, the themes of the liturgical dramas. See, liturgical dramas were written in the most popular biblical tales. Now, the themes were biblical tales like Daniel in the Lion's Den. These dramas were based on these stories of the Bible. Then the Foolish Virgins. Then the story of the Passion and the death of Jesus, etc. See, story of Passion means all the hardships, all the pain, all the torments that Jesus Christ went through while he was crucified. And when he was doing something for the salvation, for the emancipation of whole mankind. So that whole event, that whole experience of Jesus Christ is called Passion. So liturgical dramas were based on the Passion of Jesus Christ and even on the death of Jesus. Then from the stories of saints, liturgical dramas were based on Virgin Mary and then Saint Nicholas. Means how these two saints, how these two holy figures performed some miracles. They are very much miraculous. They suddenly came for help to some poor people or some affected people. So dramas were just like this. Then later Middle Ages. See, this later Middle Age became the precursor of modern drama, which gave rise to the modern dramas, and modern dramas developed to such a level that later on Christopher Marlowe, then William Shakespeare, like such dramatists came up. So later Middle Ages, from 1300 to 1485, in whole Europe especially, three vernacular dramas were very, very much famous, like miracle dramas, then mystery dramas, and moral dramas or moral plays. So we will see that later Middle Ages dramas became somewhat secular. They started including some secular elements into them, and then later on the whole scenario of the drama changed, or we can say the drama became quite opposite to the mimes or the liturgical drama. Means that they become fully secular. See, miracle plays or saints plays, they are also called, they were written in vernacular, or they are called vernacular dramas. And you see, these dramas were very much popular, not only in Britain, but in the whole Europe. Because of one movement, that is Reformation, means a religious reformation was taking place. Protestantism was coming up against Roman Catholicism. So miracle plays were becoming very much popular. Then you see, miracle plays present a real or fictitious account of the life, miracles, or martyrdom of a saint. And that means that they are very much secular, you can say. Means instead of gods, instead of holy figures, miracle dramas were based on some saints. And some were saints are like human figures. And then Mary and Nicholas had active cults during the Middle Ages. And you see, in the High Middle Age, there were so many cults, there were so many creed based on the Mary and Nicholas. They believed in them. That's why miracle plays became very popular among them, and among such cults. Then belief in healing powers of saintly relics. And you see, at that time, people believed in the saintly powers, or the miraculous power, or healing powers of saintly relics. Relics means their remains, means like their hair, like their pot or something. For example, we always read the stories of Holy Grail, which is actually a pot in which Jesus Christ took wine at the time of Eucharism or Eucharist. Then second drama which became very popular in high or later Middle Age, which is called morality plays. Morality plays were actually allegorical dramas. Allegorical means they represented abstract ideas. The characters were abstract ideas actually in Europe, especially during the 15th and 16th centuries. The characters personify moral qualities such as charity or vice or abstractions as death or youth. So moral lessons are taught. Morality plays, as the title itself shows, that they showed some moral, or they taught some moral lessons to the audience. Now, the themes of the morality plays. See, means you can here see that how English or middle age dramas were moving towards secularism or moving towards humanism in their subject matter, in their themes. So see the morality plays. The action of the morality play centers on a hero, such as Mankind. See, means there is a very famous or very popular drama which is known as morality drama. In that drama, the hero is Mankind, or the hero is every man whose inherent weaknesses are assaulted by such personified diabolic forces as the seven deadly sins. See, Christianity believes that man is born with some sins with and they are called seven deadly sins, and every man is under the effect of those seven deadly sins. So in morality plays, the hero is actually inherently having those sins. But you see, after the advent of Jesus Christ, it is believed that man is free being. If man will try hard to salvate himself or to redeem himself, so definitely he can redeem with some good qualities and can salvate himself from the seven deadly sin. So in this morality play, Mankind, who is having this weakness, but who may choose redemption and enlist the aid of such figures as the four daughters of God. And who are the four daughters of God? Like mercy, justice, temperance, and truth. So this drama is showing morality in such a concretized format. Means how man is very weak, man is inherently very weak, but if he takes the help of God or the daughters, four daughters of God, so he will cause his own salvation. Now, the examples of morality plays. Two examples are very famous, not only in Britain, but in the whole Europe. First one is The Castle of Perseverance, which is a very lengthy, which is very long drama written in 3,600 lines. And it is known as one of the oldest morality plays. And one more morality play, which is a very secular one, and its title is Every Man, one of the greatest, and it's still performed. See, this drama is very famous that even today it is performed occasionally. Now, the third type of later middle age drama is mystery plays. See, this mystery play is highly philosophical because in the mystery plays, the dramatists or through the dramas, men try to know the secrets, the mysteries of creation, even the mystery of Adam and Eve and the murder of Abel and the last judgment. And I mean, so how the last day, the doomsday will come, and who will be doomed, who will be condemned that day. So the mystery plays are based on these things. And you see, mystery play, miracle play, and the moral plays, all these plays are actually based on Bible, based on the Bible. And so Middle Age is religious age, full of the reign of Christianity. That's why the dramas were also based on the Bible or the stories of the Bible. Now, the last thing that I will include in my session, and after this thing I will conclude my session, because this much is there to share with you in the Middle Age. See, interludes. Interludes are actually the first form of modern dramas. Interludes actually literally means, interlude means, inter means between. Ludes means ludus. Ludus means a place. Means a play which was performed, which was played, which was acted between two things. And it was very much worldly, which was very much secular. So interludes became the precursor of the modern dramas. See, interludes, they refer to the playing between the courses of a banquet. Means interludes were played, they were acted in a party. means when the Christians had a party, a banquet, so in that banquet they used to have a small piece of drama, and that drama is actually called, or a play is called, interlude. Then it refers to the forms of light relief provided between episodes of a more serious nature. So you see, interludes were played in some serious things, in which some light relief or the relief was given to the audience. And you see, in these interludes, some secular things were showed to the audience. Or simply, means interludes simply refer to dialogue between two or more plays or players. So they are called interludes. And these interludes became the precursors. They became the base of the modern dramas. And you see, after the interludes, Britishers, Westerners thought that we should develop interludes into secular dramas. And then one by one, even the rulers, kings supported interludes, and they became full-fledged dramas later on. Now, with these few slides, I would like to conclude my session. Thank you very much, all the participants, for bearing with me and having or sharing with me this very hard to share or hard to understand topic, that is middle age. And I hope that this session will help you somewhat, not so much, for your preparation of examination and as well as the competitive exams. Thank you very much, each and every one of you. Thank you.
Really such a nice information from your side we got, sir. On behalf of JT management, principal, staff and students, I extend my sincere gratitude to Professor Munawwar, accuracy coordinator and resource person of this technical session, for sharing his valuable guidance by providing feast of knowledge. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Now, dear participants, we conclude this webinar right here with the hope that after completion of this webinar, you will share your feedbacks so that we improve ourselves, because there is no better way to the improvement than the feedback of the participants. And then we will try our best to dispatch you or send you or post your certificates. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. एंड कौन से कर दिया डायरेक्ट.